It was on a Southwest flight where all great conversations start. And I sat next to a guy and we started talking about just like influence and impact. And it really shifted my perspective that influence actually is impact. And if you can impact people's lives to the point where they go home and they drive home and they're calling either their mom or their best friend or their significant other. And they're like, I met the nicest person today and there's something different about her. And just like leaving that extra impact, just shine the light into the darkness in a better perspective for God's kingdom.
We are excited today. We are fired up. Today, we get to share the two-year vision of where we believe that God is calling us as a church to move forward. So we're going to share that with you. We're going to share that at the end of the teaching because we're in week five of our series where we're talking about living a life that's larger than likes. And what I hope you're taking away so far is that every person has influence, that you are a person of influence. Like you have influence no matter who you are or your job or where you are on the org chart. Every person has influence. One of my favorite examples of this came from a photo that went viral a few years back. Maybe you remember it. This photo was taken by this little girl's grandmother. It was taken at Disney, and she took this picture because the security guard went up to her granddaughter and said, "Excuse me, princess, can I have your autograph?" And she said, I could see in his little notebook that there were many, many scribbles from little kids of where he had asked for autographs. She said, my granddaughter was amazed that he thought she was a real princess. And I love that story because like that wasn't on his job description. Like that wasn't part of the playbook. That just came from inside. And he didn't do it for the gram. He didn't do it for the likes. He didn't make sure that the scene was perfectly set and, hey, can somebody take a picture? It was just this natural moment that, in a way, he demonstrated influence that he made this little girl's day. He didn't do it for the likes. He did it for the little girl. And, like, that's the magic kingdom. And in the kingdom of God, Jesus teaches us that influence is larger than likes, that life is not a performance, but that influence comes through things that we've talked about, like humility and integrity and love and faithfulness. And today we're going to talk about generosity. I want you to think about it. The people who are most influential in your life are the people who are most generous. They're the people who share of their time, of their energy, of their resources. They're generous people. Now, when you came into this world, and we were all born, and when infants are born, they have this natural reflex. Their reflex, and you've seen it in little kids and babies, their reflex is to grip. I mean, I remember when our kids were born, I held the infant, and I'm holding Raleigh in my hands. I'm holding her, and I don't call her the infant, but like I'm holding Raleigh, my oldest. I remember when she came, and I took my finger, and I put it in her little hand, and she just gripped my finger. And I was just like, this is amazing. She knows I'm her dad. And then I realized that she did that with everybody. But like there was this, there's this moment as a child that you see their hands grip. And it's this reflex that happens. It's one of our first reflexes. But then there's also something that happens at the end of life. And many people at the end of their life, as they're laying in a hospital bed, will go and they'll grip hold of the rail. One of the last reflexes in life is to grab hold of the rail or grab hold of the sheets, and then we take our last breath and we relax our grip. And to think about life is in between both of those hospital rooms where our tendency is to grip. And we can go through our entire lives clutching our fists, white-knuckling our way through life when God wants to teach us how to live a life that is free, that trusts Him. Living life open-handed. There was a book that was written a few years back. It was called Give and Take. And it's not like a religious book. It's more of an academic book. And after decades of research, what the author says, he says people can be categorized into three different groups. He says there are takers. These are people who take more than they give. He said there are matchers. These are people who are quid pro quo. They're the ones who kind of, I'll scratch your back, you scratch mine kind of people. And then he said there are givers. And givers are people who don't keep score. He said they're others focused. And the book, it's a great read, but there's a fascinating chapter. The most memorable for me was a chapter about Adam Rifkin. And Adam Rifkin is the most connected person on LinkedIn. Forbes magazine said that he is the most connected person in U.S. business. And so asking, how did he become that connected? How did he become that connected with that many most influential people? How did that happen? And here's what he said. He said, it's the 5-minute rule. He said he found that if he could do something in 5 minutes or less to help the person in front of him, he did it. He said he would ask the question of people, what can I do to help you? He said, if it took less than 5 minutes, I just did it. And he was generous. He gave of his time, of his energy, of his resources, of his connections, of his advice. He just gave generously in with that 5-minute rule and became the most connected person, the most influential person in that way. And there was this phrase used to describe him that I thought was just captured me. It says he was habitually generous. I love that. He was habitually generous. A habit is something that you do without thinking, and it was just he was just habitually generous in his life, which made me think, like, there's one of three options. We're either habitually takers, habitually matching, or we're habitually generous. Now, this habitually generous life, let me give you a definition of being habitually generous. If you're taking notes, you can write it down. A habitual generous person is spontaneously motivated to give, understands how to give, and gives the right amount at the right time. A habitually generous person is spontaneously motivated to give, understands how to give, and gives the right amount at the right time. Now, it's not just money, it's all of life. It's giving of your time, and it's giving of your energy, it's giving of your resources, it's giving of your talents, it's giving of advice, it's giving of connections and relationships, it's giving of space at the table. It's this habitually generous life. It's like the security guard giving his attention and a word of encouragement. It's giving the chips. Somebody said, yeah. Somebody just had a moment, right? So I was at Chipotle last week with my kids, and we were sitting around the table and we're having dinner, and they're old enough where they're ordering bowls now. And so I'm just trying to get over that. And I'm like, you sure you don't want the kids' quesadilla? So everybody got bowls, and then I thought, well, you know what, we'll get a bag of chips for the table. And so when you get the chips at Chipotle, what you find is the bag is this big, but they fill it to about right here. And this is a classic dad move. It's called the chip rip. And so you just rip off the top, because what you want to do, you want to see what you're working with. You want to know what you're working with here, and you want everybody to be able to get into the chips. And so at that moment, the moment when I did the chip rip, the kids start going for chips. And the way this works is, like, everybody's like real nice at first. Like taking one chip at a time and kind of going around, like there's an order to it. And nobody set the rules. Nobody said, this is what we're going to do. Kids just start taking one chip at a time. And then we start making our way. And if you have kids, you know how this goes. Or maybe if you're a human, you know how this goes. Then it starts going, well, I'm going to take 2 chips. And then I'm going to take 3 chips. And then it's like this piranha feeding frenzy. Like with hands going all over the place, and chips start, and then people start hoarding their piles of chips. And everybody's keeping score with who has how many chips. And at first I get mad. I'm like, you guys are eating all the chips. And then I get sucked into the game. And then I start going for chips too. And it's just like this moment where everybody's digging for the chips. And in that moment, I forgot. I forgot I'm the dad. I forgot I can buy more chips. But I got so sucked into this scarcity mentality where I forgot. And I thought, this is all the chips there are. And that can happen in life too, can it? Where we get so focused on the chips where we think this is all the chips there are. And we forget that there are more chips. And we forget that they only cost $1.30. I expended that much in emotional energy, I tell you. And I'm just going, I forgot that there were more chips. And what happens when we forget that there are more chips, we start counting chips. We start comparing our chips with other people's chips. We start protecting our chips, and we start hoarding our chips. and we make it all about the chips. And we lose the joy of the meal together because we make it all about our chips. And I thought, you know what? We can forget that we have a Father in heaven. We can forget that we have a Father in heaven who has more chips. Scripture tells us that he owns everything and that he is a giver. You understand that, right? God is a giver. It's who he is. It's his nature. Scripture tells us in John 3:16, it says, "For God so loved the world that he what? That he gave. He gave his one and only son. He gave his only son that whoever believes in him won't perish but have eternal life." God loves you so much that he gave his son for you. Now, I love you, but I'm not giving my son for you. In fact, if we were walking across the street and it was you and one of my boys walking across the street and a car was coming and I had to choose between one of my boys and you, I'm sorry. You're going down. I'm picking my boy. But it's unfathomable how much God loves you. It's beyond understanding that he gave his son for you. And you need to know that God is a giver in that way. He gave his son, and then Romans makes the connection that if we gave the son, then we can trust him for everything else. So he says, if God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also, along with him, graciously give us all things? You say, he gave the best, you can trust him with the rest. See, God is going to give us everything that we need. Now, he's not going to give us everything that we want. But he'll give us everything that we need because God is a giver. And we see it in Jesus. Jesus said, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. In other words, Jesus is perfect theology. If you want to study God, study Jesus. Because Jesus, fully God, fully man, he reveals to us who God is in his nature and in his attributes. And Jesus is a giver. Jesus is a habitually generous person. He gives. All throughout the Gospels, you see that he gives. In Luke 7:12, it says that Jesus gave life. He goes to a funeral, and there's a funeral going on, and they're carrying the casket of a boy, and Jesus goes, and he walks up to the casket. He sees the mom weeping, the widow weeping. He sees the mom who doesn't have a husband, and now she doesn't have a son, and Jesus goes up, and he touches the casket, and he tells the boy to get up. And the boy gets, Jesus knows how to ruin a funeral. He does. The boy gets up and comes back. I was just like, Jesus gives life. In Luke 7:21, it says that right after that, shortly after that, it says that people were coming to him to be healed, and Jesus healed the blind. Jesus gave sight. It says that Jesus called his disciples, and he empowered them to go and do ministry. Jesus gave power, and on and on and on. He gave food. He gave food to his enemies. Jesus gave light. Jesus gives his own life. He says that the Son of Man didn't come to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many. What you see in Scripture is that Jesus is not a matcher and Jesus is not a taker. Jesus is a giver. Man, he's all the time giving. He teaches people without charging tuition. He heals people without charging a copay. Can I get an amen? You go through and you just read through Scripture. You see he fed people and he didn't run up a tab. He loved people and he didn't give a prenup. I mean, you just look at Jesus. He's loving people and he's giving. It's who he is. He gave his life. And he gives salvation for free. You can't pay for it. It's free. We are saved by grace through faith, through trusting him. It's not by works that any of us would be able to say, yeah, I did this and now I'm saved. No, you can't earn it. You can buy your way into the magic kingdom and they make you. But in the kingdom of God, you can't buy your way in. You can't buy your way in. Like it's by grace, through faith. We trust him. That's how we enter into the kingdom. And Jesus teaches about, the way we use our resources. In fact, there's a scripture I want to show you. Let me just say this. Maybe one way I've failed you as a pastor is that I don't talk about money much. And I think one reason that I don't talk about money much is because, and maybe that needs to change. But one reason I don't talk about money much is because I don't want you to think the primary way or the primary thing that God is after is your money. And I don't want you to think that God is after your money and that if you give money, you can buy your way into the kingdom because you can't buy your way into the kingdom. But I was thinking, you know, Jesus talked a lot about money. Jesus talked more about money than he did heaven and hell. Jesus talked about more about money than he did anything else, because he knows that the way we use our resources is connected with our heart. Look at what he says in Matthew chapter 6, verse 21. It says, "For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also." What he's saying is the way we spend our money reflects where our heart is. If you want to know where your heart is, follow your treasure. If you want to know where your heart is, look at your checkbook. If you want to know where your heart is, look at your bank statement. If you want to know where your heart is, look at your credit card bill. If you want to know where your heart is, follow your money. And as you follow your money, you see what you care about, what you're committed to. And I think the reason Jesus taught about it so much is because he knew that money would be the primary competition for God in the center of our hearts. That the temptation would be that it would be the thing that we trust in, and it would be the thing that we depend on. It would be the thing that we live for. And so Jesus knew that it could become the primary influence in our hearts. And so he taught a lot about it, because he knows that when we live life like this, white knuckling what we have has us. And it puts a chokehold on our heart, and it'll put a chokehold on relationships. It'll put a chokehold on a marriage. And that when we're wound up with worry over what we have and up for what we don't have, it keeps us from living a habitually generous life. And Jesus wanted to show us there's a better way to live. Open-handed, with an open heart, to be habitually generous. I learned about habitual generosity in a profound way a couple years ago at Chipotle. There was an encounter that I had, and I've shared this story before. And if you've heard this story, I just want you to do what my wife does when I share stories more than once. She just smiles and says, "That's nice." So just do that right there. I was at Chipotle with the family, and we went. And, you know, if you got a big family and you go to Chipotle, you're getting nervous because you know what the tab's going to be. So I'm nervous and I'm waiting in line. And this guy walks up, and he says, "Hey, man, I need a bus ticket to get back home. Will you buy me a bus ticket?" Which is an odd place to have this conversation in line at Chipotle. I said, "Man," I said, "I don't have money for a bus ticket." And he said, "Will you buy me a burrito?" I'm like, "Man, I see what you did. Like, you went high and then you went low." I'm like, "That's smart, man. That's a smart move." I was like, "I feel like I should reward that." And so I tell him, "Yeah, man, I'll buy you a burrito." And so he gets in line with my family, and it's all my family up here. And then this guy, his name is Reed. He's standing there, and I'm waiting for him. And I said, "Man, I just wanna buy you a burrito, Reed, and I wanna do it just in Jesus' name." And so we're going through, and we start getting the food, and he asks for a burrito, and then he starts loading that thing up. And I'm watching him, and he says, "I'll take double steak." And I'm like, "Well, okay." And so then he takes double steak, and then, you know, I'm watching, they load that thing up, and he's asking for more. He got everything. The kitchen sink got thrown in there. And then he goes on, and then he says, "And you know what I'm watching for? You know what I'm wondering, right? Is he going to get the guac?" Because why? Guac's extra. And right now, Reed is extra. He really is. And I'm like, I've heard beggars can't be choosers, but he is. He's choosing everything. And so I'm watching this go down, and they load that thing up with guac, and then he goes ahead, gets chips, and he gets a Coke, and I'm like, "Kid's got water, but Reed's getting a Coke." And so we get through, and they wind his burrito up, and he turns to me, and he says, "Thank you," and then he leaves, and I go and I sit down with my family, and I'm just ticked, because I got taken advantage of. I'm sitting there going, "This guy took advantage of me. Like, I just said he could get a burrito. I didn't say he could get guac. I didn't say chips, I didn't say a Coke, but he got." And so then I'm sitting there in that moment, and I'm sitting with the family, and it just completely took my joy. Like, it robbed me of my joy. And kids are like, "Why is Dad mad?" Well, Reed. And so I'm sitting there. So we get done, and I get back home. That next morning, I wake up and just praying, and I'm still bothered by, you ever been bothered by something the day after? I'm still bothered by this thing. And some of you are expecting that I would be more spiritually mature than that. But I'm bothered. And I just, with the Lord, I'm like, "God, why is this bothering me so much?" And I feel he's saying, "Because Reed didn't scam you. You scammed Reed." I'm like, "What do you mean?" "Well, you said that you did that in Jesus' name. And that wasn't in Jesus' name." And then I began to imagine, "Well, God, what would it have been like if I would have done that in Jesus' name?" I rewind the tape, and I think, "Man, I would have said, 'Hey, get your burrito. And man, get you some of that corn. That corn's good. And why don't you get double steak? I mean, throw down. You want some chicken in there too? Throw that down too. And man, I'll tell you what, there's going to be guac. And it's going, don't worry about it. Guac's, I'm like, hey, and get you some chips and get you a Coke. And why don't you come share the meal with my family? Like, that's what it would look like to do it in Jesus' name. I thought, that's who I want to be. I want to be a habitually generous person. Not that even when I give, I white knuckle and try to control. I said, I just want to be a person who is habitually generous. Let's go back to the definition. Habitually generous person is spontaneously motivated to give, understands how to give, and the how to give is in Jesus' name. With the heart of Jesus. How to give and gives it the right amount, gives the right amount at the right time. I want to give in Jesus' name. I want to be habitually generous. I want to have a heart like Jesus. And Jesus said, where your treasure is, there your heart is also. And you know what Jesus treasured? He treasured people. That's what Jesus treasured. You go through and you read the Gospels, you see Jesus treasured people. He treasured you more than he treasured his own life. Jesus treasured people. And what does it look like to treasure people and to be habitually generous? Jesus said, I've come to seek and save that which is lost. So lost people matter to Jesus. And Jesus said, I am like the shepherd who leaves the 99 to go after the one. He says, I'm going after the one, and you're the one that he goes after. I'm the one that he goes after. He leaves the 99 to go after the one because Jesus treasures people. Now, over the last 4 weeks, we've talked about how do we use our influence, the influence that God has given us, how do we use that influence to leverage our influence for the kingdom? And so what I want to do is I want to talk, because over the past 9 months, we've been talking as a leadership team, and we've been talking as a board, talking as a staff, and praying, going, okay, God, how do we leverage our influence as a church? In these next 2 years, how do we leverage our influence in Middle Tennessee? How do we leverage our influence together? And we're calling it For the One. And so what I want to do, I want to share with you in the rest of our time, I want to share with you where we believe that God is leading us together. And there may be some things in this that you want to jot down, but I just love to just share the heart behind it. And it goes back to what we were praying. And we're praying together and came across a verse. It's in 1 Peter 5:7. It says, cast all your anxiety on him because he cares for you. This is a great verse. Basically what this means is that you can trust God with the things that worries you. God says, cast your cares on me because I care for you. It means if it matters to you, it matters to God. Don't you love that? That God's saying, if it matters to you, if it has your word, I want you to just cast it on me. And I think one of the reasons God says, cast your cares on me because I care for you is because a measure of spiritual maturity is when we say, God, would you reveal to me what you care about? See, when we give God our anxieties, it makes space and room in our hearts for us to say, God, we want to care about the things you care about. And so we read through scriptures and we look at the life of Christ and we say, God, what do you care about? And when we look in scripture, he makes it obvious that he cares about lost people. He cares about lost people. He cares about people who have lost their way. He cares about people who don't yet know the truth and the grace of Jesus, the hope that only Jesus can give. And so he's asking CrossPoint, do you care about lost people? Do you care about people who are far from God? And I know that you do. And we think about, okay, how do we reach more people? It makes us think about how do we maximize space in our current facilities and how do we start more campuses? How do we maximize space and how do we plant more churches? And when we think about maximize space, we think of the Franklin campus. We think about what's going on at Franklin. And Franklin is busting at the seams. I just heard an amen coming all the way from Franklin here in Nashville, right? Franklin is busting at the seams. And a few years ago, we had an opportunity to move into our current space in Franklin. And moving into that space was great, but we weren't in a position to purchase that property because we'd just come off a 10-month transition without a pastor, without a lead pastor. And so we signed a lease purchase and with a three-year, it's a three-year lease purchase. And the time to purchase is coming up in 2020. And so we have an opportunity to purchase. So we want to purchase the Franklin campus, but at the same time, we know that we're currently busting at the seams, and so we need more space. And so we want to build a new auditorium, 750-seat auditorium in Franklin, which would convert the existing space to this awesome, just amazing space for students and for kids and for the next gen. And so all of that going on, we'd love to get started on that. We want to get started on that in the summer of 2020. And so that's maximizing the current space in Franklin. And we want to reach more people there, but then at the same time, we know we want to reach more families. And the best way to reach more families is through starting more campuses. And so we'll start the Hendersonville campus in January of 2020, and things are in motion for that. We'll have more exciting things to share with you in the weeks ahead on the Hendersonville campus, details for that. But then we're also going, okay, what's the next location for us? And so we believe the next location would be somewhere south of Franklin, and so it's around Columbia and Spring Hill. And some of you are wondering, well, how do you decide where to put the campuses? We just look for a Martin's Barbecue, and we just go really close to that. We just think God is in that, and they've got great wings. And so, no, there are more data points than that, and I'll be happy to share another time. But it looks like that would be the next location. Some of you have friends or even family members that live down south of Franklin, and so we'd be excited. We're excited about that. But we realize with 100 people moving here a day, we can't wait for more campuses and our rollout of more campuses to reach Nashville, reach the metro area. And so we're going to be partnering with local church planters. We're going to be partnering to plant more churches, not just CrossPoint, but more churches across the metro area, because we know what God is doing is bigger than CrossPoint. And so we want to partner with what he's doing with church planters that he's bringing to the city and also globally. Our mission is to help people find and follow Jesus. And so we want to do that with global church partners and planting churches globally as well. And then you're wondering, well, how do we resource this with leaders? And you're going to hear more about this, but we want to start a residency program that would raise up and train the next generation of leaders, a 2-year program where we're spiritual leaders and creatives in the city. Nobody wants to leave Nashville when they graduate college. They all want to stay. And there are some that God's called to ministry, and we'll share more about how we want to develop them and raise up leaders as well. And so God cares about lost people. He cares about families. He cares about kids. You read the scriptures, Jesus said, "Let the children come to me." And we want to tear down every obstacle that we can that would keep children from hearing about Jesus. And in Mount Juliet, that means tearing down walls. Because Mount Juliet, when we moved into that space in January of 2017, actually when we started in January of 2017 and moved into that space after that, we realized that we would need to go phase 2 on kids. But what we didn't realize is how fast we need to do it. Because Mount Juliet, you're making a lot of babies out there. You are. They're a baby-making campus. And then just reaching the community. And there are a lot of families in Mount Juliet. And we realize if we don't do something there, soon that we'll be turning families away. We don't want to turn families away because of kids' space. And so we've got plans to tear down walls and make more space for kids. And we want to open up that space in August of 2020 and to make those changes as well. God cares about kids, and God cares about the most vulnerable. He cares about the most vulnerable. When you read through Scripture, Jesus tells us, he says, "That which you do to the least of these, you've done it unto me." That which you do to the least of these, you've done unto me. And he says, when you visit in prison, you visited me. And so we love what God's doing through God Behind Bars. We love the work that's happening there week in and week out. That there is a service that meets every single week, and they experience the same thing that we do here. And we want to say to the ladies at God Behind Bars, we love you, and we're so grateful that we get to be in this together with what God's doing in Middle Tennessee. But we also know that God is moving in a significant way. I had some numbers I wanted to share with you. For the past 4 years, the church has been meeting in Tennessee Prison for Women. Over that time period, we've seen 347 ladies make a commitment to follow Jesus. Yeah. And there have been 66 women who have been baptized. This past Christmas, when I was out at the Dixon campus, a woman came up to me. She said her name was Candy. And she said, "This is my first weekend at CrossPoint." She said, "I just got out of Tennessee Prison for Women, and I was a part of God Behind Bars." And she said, "This is the first thing that I've done. I had to borrow clothes to come to church today. I had to get a ride to church. She said, but the first thing that I wanted to do when I got out was come to CrossPoint, because you made a difference in my life. That's what we get to be a part of together. Well, the prison recognizes what God's doing is working there, and so they've come to us and asked. They said, hey, there's an annex, which is a separate population from the general population. So the women who are in the annex, which is kind of like a transitional center, they're not able to be a part of the God Behind Bars service that we do. So they said, could you start another God Behind Bars service for the women in the annex? And so they asked, and we said, well, let's pray about it. Yes, we can start that. And so Pastor Doug and the team that's working there, volunteers, we say, yes, we want to be a part of that. Well, we believe that God is calling us to do that, to start that service in the annex. And we're excited to start that, and we want to start that in January of 2020. Because what God's saying is, I care about the vulnerable among you. I care about the lost. Care about the families. Care about the kids. Care about raising up the next generation of leaders. And I care about the most vulnerable among you. And we're just saying, God, we want to care about what you care about. Well, God says, I care about the one. I was looking back over the last 2 years and looking for just the number of people who have been baptized. And this number is the number of people who have been baptized over the past 2 years. 1,521 people. And yeah, we exist to help people find and follow Jesus. And what I love about this number is, what does it end with? A one. We do this for the one. And while churches might count in hundreds and thousands, what God reminds us is that he counts by one. And all this for the one. And what Jesus says, I would do all of this for the one. And you're the one, and the ones who aren't here yet. And so what I want you to see is, as we're talking about what we believe God's called us into, I mean, it really is, it's for the one. It's for the one. And so some of you are wondering, you're like, well, what does this cost for us to be a part of? What does this cost for us to do together? Well, I'm glad you asked. Over the next 2 years, it's going to cost $6 million above and beyond what we normally do. $6 million above and beyond over the next 2 years. But before the end of the year, for us to get started, it'll require $1.5 million. That's a lot of chips and guacamole. So how do we do that? I'll tell you how we do that and how these things work. Is you just ask God, God, what would you have me do? And then you just do that. Around CrossPoint, we say that prayer is not the only thing we do, it's the first thing we do. And so it's just asking God, God, how would you have me be a part of For the One? And just do what he asks you. And if he doesn't ask you to do anything, then don't do anything. But whatever he puts on your heart, just respond in that way. And what we see is God brings all of those parts together to do something bigger than we could ever do on our own. It's prayer and obedience. And so if you're thinking, man, I want to learn more. I want to know more about what's happening. Because some of you are already making plans for year-end giving. And our year-end offering is For the One. Then you can go to CrossPoint.tv/For the One. There you can find out more information. You can also, at that place, if you're ready to jump in already, if you already know, then you can jump in and you can let us know there online and go ahead and jump in with For the One. There are a lot of projects. But over here, it's not about projects. It's about people. That's the reason we're doing all of this. It's about people. It's about people like Reed standing in line. Like when we talk about generosity, it's about people. And what, if I could go back to that moment, I would have done things differently because I would have wanted Reed to see Jesus. That's the purpose of generosity. It's not just on Sunday. It's not just with something like this. It's all of life that we give of our time, our energy, our relationships, and our resources so that people would see Jesus. But with For the One, it's that each one would see Jesus. And we just hear stories of this, how people are seeing Jesus around CrossPoint, stories like Ricky, a story I want to share with you. And then our campus pastors will step up at our campuses and lead in prayer. Check it out.
So it was October 27th, walking into Franklin campus. You know, in 5 days, I was about to get married. So as I walked into the pews, that's on my mind, right? I'm so excited to get ready to step into marriage in 5 days. So walk into church, sit down, and then there's Kevin Robinson, the man who's about to marry us in those 5 days. He was kicking off the service, letting everybody know it was Baptism Sunday. He said that, and I kind of got a twinge of like, huh, that's cool. When we switched over to Kevin Queen and he started speaking about your front stage and your backstage, that started connecting with me. Because I kind of felt that, you know, my backstage was, you know, Jesus, and my front stage, I wasn't portraying it. I was sitting in the pews, and then they began to start the baptisms. The music was playing, some of my favorite songs were playing, and I just felt an overwhelming feeling right kind of when they started the baptisms. I remember, you know, gripping the pews, just, you know, putting my head down and just listening to God, who I've never heard his voice before this. I just said a quick prayer and I was like, you have to calm me down if I'm gonna go over here and if I'm gonna go up there and get baptized. So, I felt a sense of calm and I looked over to my fiance at the time and I was like, I think I wanna do this. I wanna go get baptized. So she came with me, we went back. Actually, Alec Humphreys, our community leader at Franklin CrossPoint, his mom was back there and she's like, oh my gosh, are you doing this right now? So she grabbed me, we took off. The whole time I just had that calm feeling and I just felt like I was being told to get up and go do this. As I was talking to Alec's mom, I just said, I'm about to be the spiritual leader of a marriage and then a potential family. That was the underlying prompt, I think, to go and do this, you know, for my wife to be the best husband that I can. But really it was the feeling of just God telling me, hey, it's time for you to go do this. As I was in there changing, you know, I heard Kevin Robinson come around the corner and he saw my almost wife standing there. And I just heard him go, no way, no way. And he just starts getting so excited. So I walked out, walked up the steps, saw him sitting there, big smile on his face. And then as I sat down in the tub is when he leaned over and asked me, he's like, man, what prompted this? What, you know, you're about to get married in 5 days, and just started pumping me up. And then I just told him I've never heard God's voice like I did to tell me to come here and do this. So it was an awesome experience to be there with him and my wife now. It was just awesome to have everybody there. Thankfulness definitely jumps out for just all the blessings that have been, you know, poured into me and given to me from, finding CrossPoint, finding the community that we have, God speaking to me, leading me, telling me what to do. So extremely thankful and very, very grateful.